Hello and welcome to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray. And believe it or not, this is our first week of Lent. Certainly we're taping these, so if I make reference to something and that I heard in church and you're going, I didn't hear that. it was maybe because we're taping early, so it may confuse you at times. But as we were talking, as we were kind of leading up to our Lenten series, you might recall that I said we are actually going to focus on one book during our Lenten series, and I tried to kind of do my best to discern where God's leading me or what he might want me to do. And after we had this guest on our show, I just went back and ordered all his books. I just went online and said, okay, anything you wrote, I'm buying. And this book happened to be the first one I picked up. And when I read the intro, I thought, oh my gosh, it's my struggle. So I would tend to think I'm not the only one that struggles. So, I thought this would be a great Lenten journey. So really it's kind of a Lenten journey that I'm inviting you into, right? Because, I think it's very powerful for each of us. The name of the book, if you recall the last couple of weeks I've been talking about it, is called Real Religion, and the subtitle, How to Avoid False Faith and Worship God in Spirit and Truth. And again, the author of this book was so gracious, because there was no way that I thought he could find time to be on the show and talk about every chapter of this book with us during Lent. And he did. He found time to do it. So I'm so excited. You've heard him before on the show, Father Jeffrey Kirby. He is a moral theologian and pastor of Our Lady of Grace Parish in Indian Land, South Carolina. He is the host of the daily devotional, The Morning Offering with Father Kirby. And when I talked about Father, different people said, oh, yeah, I listened to him on Morning Offering. Father Kirby's written several books, including Sanctify Them in Truth, How the Church's Social Doctrine Addresses the Issues of Our Time. That's not the book we're using for Lent, however. We're using Real Religion. Welcome, Father Kirby. How are you doing today?
Good, Pat. Thank you for being on the show, and thank you for this opportunity to talk about Real Religion.
Well, you know, when I read the intro, it grabbed my attention. It just hooked me, because I thought, oh, yeah. This is kind of what we all deal with. And I was in parish work for a while, and I'm a parishioner. So, you know, when you started this story about somebody who comes in and wants to talk to you and just kind of criticizes the whole worship service, you know, mass that, you know, it's repetitive. It's kind of boring. The music's kind of not good. You know, we're not very welcoming. And I'm thinking, oh, some of those words have slipped out of my mouth over the years. Is that the thing that led you to really look at what's going on in this area?
Yeah. So, you know, the book, that experience that's told there, as you mentioned in the intro, and then just so many experiences through, you know, over 15 years of priesthood, especially in terms of worship, where people just, more and more it became clear to me that there wasn't a clear understanding or an appreciation for what worship really is. Mm-hmm. And, you know, biblically, there's the principle that if you get worship right, you get life right. Mm. And inversely, if you don't get worship right, then you're not going to be able to get life right.
Yeah.
And so really it was just the collection by memory of different conversations and experiences and movements and demands over the years by people where I thought, you know, I just need to sit down, at first for myself, just kind of process, okay, how do I explain point by point by point why some of these are problematic or exaggerated? And then that work just eventually led to, well, let me develop this in a popular sense so that maybe it can help some people begin to understand what worship really is in terms of the scriptures, in terms of the Catholic and Apostolic faith.
Yeah. And I, you know, as I was reading this, I gave a presentation last night in a parish, and some people were standing around afterwards and talking, and one of them made mention of a number of people that have gone, who have left the Catholic Church for a church that, you know, the music is better, it's more active, you know,
right.
And this, and your words are ringing in my head, you know, this idea of what really worship is and how we just don't understand it. And don't you think, and I know I'm kind of probably jumping a little bit around here, but don't you think part of it is so much attached to where we are as a culture? I mean, everything has to be entertaining. It's very much about me, you know, selfies. I'm taking selfies. Never heard of that years ago. What is that? You couldn't take a picture of yourself. You know,
right.
I mean, it just makes sense to me, right? That this is where we've come with worship, that it's no longer about God. And you say that, but where is God? You keep bringing us back to that. Do you see it as related to a more cultural thing, or is it bigger than that?
No. I think it definitely involves the culture. I think there's, of course, more like our fallen nature, misunderstanding of grace. You know, the receiving of grace through the sacraments, that's all, of course, a question, but also very much these cultural trends. You know, one of the quotes I put in the book is by Mark Twain, where, you know, he says, God made man in his image, and man is forever trying to repay the favor, you know?
That's very true.
And we do that even in worship, where we're saying, God, you have to entertain me, I have to have euphoria, if I don't feel it, it's not real, and really, like, our emotional state becomes the standard of all being. And, you know, and when I talk about that to people, I say, you know, it's really just a path to misery, because I said, you know, I could turn up the heat, physically turn up the heat in a room and change your emotion.
Yeah.
I could drop the temperature and make it cold in a room and change your emotions.
Mm-hmm.
You can skip a meal and get hungry and your emotions change. Like, our emotions can be beautiful gifts,
right?
But they can be very fickle. So, you know, in our spiritual tradition, we say that the emotions make great servants, but terrible masters,
right? Yeah.
You know, and I think when we impose that on worship, we get ourselves in trouble, because in the end, ultimately, we're just worshiping ourselves, and more specifically, in many cases, we're just worshiping our own desire for emotional euphoria.
And one of the things you talk about, and I know I'm still in the introduction. I know we're supposed to be talking about chapter one, and I'm still in the introduction. But you talk, because you're sharing experiences of you know, being a pastor, and I noticed this too when I was in parish work, that sacraments as children, you know, receive first communion, these sacraments, that parents a lot of times almost see these as kind of a rite of passage or a magical moment. They really don't have the depth. And so if you say, well, you know, we would like your child to wait, they think, well, who are you, right? Who are you to deny my child this sacrament? Can you help us understand that a little bit? Because that is prevalent.
Yes. I think the first part with that is the misunderstanding of worship, as we're talking about. I think also the real loss of the understanding that the sacraments have been given to us in order to receive grace, in order to be faithful disciples. Mm. So the sacraments are this food, this fuel to the soul by grace, in order for us to live the Christian way of life. So I'm called to forgive someone, I don't want to give them mercy. Mm. Well, grace can help me do that. I am called to selfless service, I don't want to. I want to relax, you know, and so, you know, I'm called out of myself. And so we have these, you know, big understandings that have been kind of eclipsed. And what that kind of eventually equates to is you have these parents who say, well, you know, I'm going to have the happy child list, mm-hmm. right? Or these rites of passage, you know. So it's like, okay, well, see Santa Claus, check. Mm-hmm. Go to Disney World, check. Receive First Holy Communion, check, right? it just becomes, like you're saying, Pat, like a rite of passage. Well, you know, parents, and God bless them, they want good parents, and they want their children to have happy childhoods. But First Holy Communion is just put on this list as if it's right there with Santa Claus and Mickey Mouse.
Mm-hmm.
And no real understanding of discipleship or the call of the Christian family or desire to really follow the way of the Lord Jesus or to regularly practice the faith. And as you're saying, then they come to the parish and say, oh, yeah, my child wants to receive First Holy Communion. Yeah, but you're not practicing the faith.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that doesn't matter.
Right.
And there have been some, like, knockout, full-on fights with families and grandparents where it's like, as you're saying, Pat, who do you think you are? You can't deny my child. So it's like, we're not denying anything. We're just saying that we need you to practice the faith for a little while so we know that the graces of the sacrament will not be received in vain.
Mm-hmm.
And that spiritual concern, that spiritual perspective, we might as well be, talking to the wall sometimes.
Yeah.
It's not there.
And
the task is to try to form it.
And I think part of that, too, comes in, obviously, even from the first moment with baptism, that people, again, look at sponsors. I've had, cases where, when I was in parish work where you said, well, okay, what are they a practicing Catholic? Well, no, but they're my brother. Well, I... Do you know what the role of a godparent is? Okay, let's take a look at this. Let's look at but there is this part, right? Let's look at the right. What does it tell us? And that's why I think so often, worship, we don't even pay attention sometimes to the words and what it's challenging us to, because the sacramental, the rites of the sacraments tell us what is expected here, and we just don't pay attention, I think, sometimes. Or again, like I said, it's kind of a rite of passage. Well, one of the things, Father, I wanted to kind of, when you talked about why you wrote this book, right, and you talk about, and I'm just going to quote this very line, this book is written out of a desire to remind us all of God's everlasting love for us and our capacity to love him back through right and real religion. So, first of all, is one of our kind of roles, especially in evangelization, and certainly as we are in this Lenten season, is we really first have to really understand the great love of God for us, right? The great love God has for me, because if I don't understand that, how am I going to respond to it? Does that make sense?
It does. And I think, almost concurrent with that, the realization of God's love for us is the realization of God's sovereignty.
Mm.
Because what we've done is we really have, especially in the West, we've domesticated God, right? Where,
yeah.
Turn him into some type of pet, where of course he's going to do what I tell him. Of course he's going to love me, right? As if he's just some beloved dog or something, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so recognizing God's love has to happen concurrently with the recognition of his sovereignty. God doesn't have to love me.
Yeah.
God is infinitely superior to me. There's no reason why God should pay any attention to me. And yet, he does, and he loves me, and he wants me to be with him forever and eternity. And that begins to provoke that sense of awe.
Yeah.
That is the birth and the help to continue with real religion.
Yeah.
It's just that awe of who am I, and look who God is. And yet he calls me to himself. He wants a relationship with me. He permits me to worship him. He allows his worship to transform and change me in order to be more like him so that I can one day be with him forever in heaven. And again, that sense of awe of, wow, like,
yeah.
that's amazing. Like, who am I? And yet God offers this to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I think that's the key. We have to refine that sense of awe and break that kind of domestication of God where he's just, again, like a beloved pet.
Thing. Right. One more thing, kind of. So, and I want to tell the audience, just in case here, the structure of this book is really great. I didn't even, when I asked you, I had only read maybe the first few pages of the introduction. I hadn't even gotten all the way to the end of the introduction when I knew this is a great book. But I want to let the audience know, the structure of this book is wonderful for Lent. It is just, like I said, the Lord leads us in these things. But, Father, you use quotes of people, saints throughout on the topic. I love the examination of conscience at the end of the chapter. You give kind of these concise points that we talk about for apologetics, which I love because a lot of times, you know, for some people, you can read a chapter and go, yeah, but what's really at the heart that I'm supposed to grab? And that is one of those things that those points for apologetics, pointers for apologetics is wonderful. And then you also add that key points to it. And then you put devotional exercises at the end. So those of you who are listening, you know, I said that if you wanted to purchase this book to go with us in this journey through Lent, but that was even before I realized how wonderful the book was, that it had, yeah. It had all this, like, you know, all the things that make Lent, you know, the understanding of God and an examination of conscience and, you know, devotional exercises. You did it all right here in this book for us. And I want to thank you for that. It's amazing. Well,
yes, and Pat, that shows just, you know, the context of you know, the writing in that, you know, as you mentioned, the opening bio, first and foremost, you know, I'm a pastor. I'm in the trenches with families and parishioners, walking with them in the joys and sufferings of life. And, you know, obviously I'm busy as a pastor. Obviously I see the busyness of the people of God. I see how they're being pulled and stretched in different directions. And if I'm going to teach something, especially something where it can be very developed and has to be kind of, you know, broken down and made digestible, if I'm going to do that, then I have to do it in such a way where it's going to, first of all, really be digestible. People can say, oh, I understand that. Now, that's actually a really good point.
Right.
And then guide them in terms of how to take this knowledge or this renewed awareness to a deeper relationship with God and to do that practically. So here's an examination of conscience. Here are some key points. And I put the key points there because we've all, you know, worked our way through a chapter at different times,
yep.
You know, like, you know, a little bit here, a little bit there. And at the end of the chapter, say, okay, now, I know that was really good, but what was that about again?
Exactly, yeah. And especially if it builds, yeah, you can go back then and easily access it. You know, so if a book builds on, you know, keeps kind of referring back to something, you can always go back and access it. It's wonderful. It really is laid out very well. Well, believe it or not, Father, I am ready to get into week one, chapter
good.
One.
Yes. All right.
It only took me 16 minutes, almost 17. So, well, one of the things you talk about, and I want to kind of put this out there right away, because I think when we hear the word worship, we think of mass. So I'm asking you, do we need a bigger definition to understand it in the context of this book?
I would say yes. But connected to the mass. So,
okay.
So we think of worship, like we have to understand that worship is the exercise of the virtue of religion,
which we're going to get
into. People when they hear that,
right?
Like, you know, because the virtue of religion is within the virtue of justice. So justice is giving to someone their due.
Yep.
So God is owed something by us,
right?
We are bound in justice to give him what is his due. And so that's the virtue of religion. Also, you know, those seven powerful gifts of the Holy Spirit that we received at confirmation, including fear of the Lord and piety. Piety is to fulfill our duties, right? And fear of the Lord is that reverential awe of God, you know, that profound gratitude to him. So I think we have to, you know, bring forth a lot of other parts of our life as the children of God, our you know, discipleship to the Lord Jesus. Let's bring this all together and understand that when we go to Mass, which is the sum and source of all worship, that there's a lot of other factors going on or should be going on interiorly in ourselves as children of God that we've received, gifts of the Holy Spirit, that are being called forth from us, the virtue of religion. There are a lot of things that are happening as we attend Mass. So worship is we can say, a holistic experience,
right? Okay.
A holistic act.
Okay.
And but with all that said is, you know, there's nothing superior, nothing more beautiful, nor profound, nor worthy of the human spirit than participation in the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass.
Yeah. Well, I must say, Father, I referenced your book last night in my talk because the very first kind of segment of this chapter is God is real. And And you make reference to that, the altar of the lie, Ananias and Sapphira, I think is how you say it. And I was blessed enough to go to Rome a number of years ago, and I remember this altar. And can you kind of tell just a brief why this story fits so well with this idea of your concept here, or not concept, but the truth of God is real?
Yes. So I wanted to start with the most basic part.
Yeah.
In terms of walking, the reader through an understanding of worship, and as you indicate, Pat, it's just a realization that God is real, and people can hear that and say, "Well, of course, God's real."
Yeah.
But let's push that a little bit.
Yeah.
So the first line of the Catechism of the Catholic Church is, "God, infinitely perfect and blessed in Himself." So He's real.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't need us to update Him. He doesn't need us to modify Him. He doesn't need us to rationalize or explain Him. He is real, just as we are real. He has real attributes. He has real ways in order for us to know Him. He's real, right?
Right.
So, and just that profound awareness that there is an objective reality of God outside of myself because He's real. And I think that shakes people up because God has become so subjectivized.
Yes.
God will be whatever I want Him to be.
Yes.
No. God understands why I've done this. Mm-hmm. God understands, like, and on and on. And we subjectify Him. So again, we domesticate God. He just becomes my pet. He's not my sovereign Lord. He's not the King of the universe. No, he's my pet who's supposed to make me feel good about myself.
Right. I don't have to conform to Him. Yeah.
Right. And so let's go to the altar of the lie. So there's this account given in Acts of the Apostles where, husband and wife lied to the apostles about the selling of land, and the husband tells a lie first, and then he's struck dead at the feet of the apostle, and then his wife's brought in, and then she repeats the lie, and then she's struck dead, and it shows just in terms of, the call that we have as disciples to integrity.
Mm-hmm.
And in St. Peter's Basilica, the account of that scene from Acts of the Apostles in this mosaic right outside the sacristy. So if you walk into St. Peter's Basilica, you look at the main altar, it's to the left transept. It's where the sacristy is located. The sacristy is a place where people prepare for worship, so priests vest and stuff like that. So,
mm-hmm.
So people are familiar with that term. And so you can imagine that, priests and people are preparing for worship in the sacristy, and they walk out of the sacristy in order to go to one of the altars within St. Peter's Basilica. And as you walk out, that's the scene, that mosaic of this scene of this couple from Acts of the Apostles is right there. There's almost a punch in the nose.
Right.
Because it's immediately calling the priests and the people who are going to participate in the holy sacrifice to integrity, to say what you believe.
Mm-hmm.
Do not lie before God or the church,
mm-hmm.
right? And I just think it's a powerful summons for all of us.
Yes.
Because, we can go to the altar of God and I love you, I follow you, I'll do whatever you tell me, and then we leave the Mass God will understand if I, cheat on my taxes. God will understand if I cheat on my wife. God mm-hmm. will understand. And suddenly, where's all that devotion? where was that obedience that you talked about at the altar? Where's that at in the midst of the world? And so it just helps us, that scene from Acts, to just call us to integrity and to realize what we say God takes very seriously.
So
what we say we are called to do.
So one of the things you talk about, and so our sure knowledge of God hinges upon and comes from God's revelation. Can you kind of, because so often, we say, well, we can't totally know God, right? So how do I know what I know for sure? As you're putting it.
Yeah. So, and let me just run with that point, Pat, that you just made, that we can't, fully know God,
mm-hmm.
Because He's infinite mystery. In fact,
right.
The Catechism of the Catholic Church says that whatever we can say about God, God is infinitely more.
Yeah.
And so because He is this eternal, infinite mystery, we call that the apophatic tradition in our theological teachings.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that God is more concealed than revealed to, mm-hmm. to us. But because of that, that should make us even more so cling to the revelations that He has given to us.
Ah.
because what we do know are the aspects that he has chosen to reveal, disclose, unveil, and we would say in popular jargon, to share
right.
with us. And so he has revealed through the course of salvation history by words and deeds aspects of himself. So revelation is God sharing his own knowledge of himself with us, which is very profound if you think about that. Like his the own knowledge that God has of himself, he shares with us.
Mm-hmm.
So I know most of us are very moved in human relationships when someone feels close enough to share aspects of their interior life with us.
Right.
And it's like, wow, that's pretty profound and very humbling. And if we can understand that in human relationships, where we're peers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Imagine God, the all-powerful, the ever-living, the ancient of days, the mighty warrior, the prince of peace, who chooses to reveal his own knowledge of himself with us. So because of that, we should cling to revelation as a lamp in the midst of darkness, knowing that that lamp is the only guide we have in order to know who God is, to not believe falsehoods about him, or to not be stuck in incomplete teachings about him, but to truly know who he is. And these revelations are given to us by his words and deeds through the course of salvation, first and foremost contained in oral tradition, and then through the movement of the ages, God raising up and blessing written accounts. So we say now sacred tradition, sacred scripture.
Right.
And so for the believer, this is what we really should be studying and holding on to, because this is what God has given to us so we can know about him, because otherwise we would never be able to know about him.
Yeah. And I think, you know, that's one of the things that I notice sometimes in scripture, and I've even been, you know, at Mass when that the passage is read that, you know, Christ says, I come to bring division, you know. And I've been at Masses where the priest doesn't want to talk about that, you know, because you know, the God that we want is the God of love and fuzziness and isn't going to push us to choose, you know. And I think that certainly plays into what you're getting at in this segment of the first chapter, is this idea of when we don't worship the true God that we know and has been revealed to us, then we have basically turned toward idolatry, which we will pick up in the second half of the show. We are already at break time. This goes by so fast, Father. I want to let the audience know that our guest today is Father Jeff Kirby, a moral theologian, pastor of Our Lady of Grace Parish in Indian Land, South Carolina. He hosts the daily devotional, The Morning Offering with Father Kirby. That pops up in my morning box, in my inbox every morning. I would encourage you to do that. Father Kirby has written several books, including Sanctify Them in Truth, How the Church's Social Doctrine Addresses the Issue of Our Time. But the book we're using for Lent, and is going to be our journey through Lent, so that we are worshiping the true God and not an idol that we have created, is the book he wrote called Real Religion. And so in this first week of Lent, we're looking at the first chapter. So come back on the other side of the break. You're listening to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray.
Listen to how St. John Paul II invites us to love the people who fill our lives. He states, since in the Sacred Heart, the believer encounters the symbol and the living image of the infinite love of Christ, which itself spurs us to love one another. Imagine a world where families are full of faith, love, and the Lord's peace. To learn about the Sacred Heart Enthronement and the Sacred Heart Devotion, visit welcomehisheart.com.
The Society of St. Vincent de Paul is one of the oldest charitable organizations in the world. Parish-based conferences answer the need for immediate, temporary assistance, providing help with rent, utilities, and other bills. Our food pantries serve thousands throughout Northwest Ohio. We make new friends every day and share in the spiritual growth that springs from charity. Ask about St. Vincent de Paul at your parish or call us at 419-244-5171.
This program is underwritten in part by the law firm of Klein, Cook & Weisenberger, now located in Perrysburg, Ohio. Online at ccw-law.com. 419-321-6444.
Hello and welcome back to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray. And I'm excited during this Lenten season. Our guest is going to be with us every week, to help us understand a book that he wrote, which is amazing, I think, and it's perfect for the Lenten season. It's Father Jeff Kirby. He is a moral theologian, pastor of Our Lady of Grace Parish in Indian Land, South Carolina, host of the daily devotional, the morning offering with Father Kirby. I would encourage you to get that. He's written several books, including Sanctify Them in the Truth, How the Church's Social Doctrine Addresses Issues of Our Time. And the book, though, that we're using for Lent is called Real Religion. And we are in week one, so we are in chapter one. And if you missed the first half of the show, please go back and pick it up on Annunciation Radio on demand. Welcome back, Father.
Thank you. It's good to be back with you, Pat.
Father, we were talking about God is real. Now, one of the things that you say, and I think this is really hard for people to understand, and you mentioned it a little bit early on in our conversation, but I want you to expand a little bit on this, because since I've been trying to enter more deeply into worship myself and listening very attentively to the Eucharistic prayers and the prefaces, this comes up in the preface. In fact, it came up this morning at Mass in the preface. But you're talking about God, and you say he's infinitely perfect. He doesn't need our help to make him any better. And you say he doesn't need our praise or adoration.
Mm-hmm.
That bothers people. And I mean, it's kind of a two-edged sword, right? Because we're supposed to go to Mass, but yet you're telling me that he doesn't need me. So what is this all about? Can you kind of help us out?
Yes, very much. And once it's understood, it actually, I think it's actually more endearing.
Yes.
Yeah, because God is infinitely perfect, blessing himself. Like, he doesn't need our worship. So if we choose not to worship, he doesn't become less of who he is. Or if we praise him and give him worship, he doesn't become more of who he is. He's infinitely perfect.
Mm-hmm.
But when we worship him, which he wants, so he doesn't need, but he wants, he calls us to worship him, because when we worship him, we actually grow more into his likeness, more into his goodness. We become holier. So our worship of God actually helps us to understand who we are, and actually helps us to grow into holiness and eventually to allow ourselves to be so transformed that we will be made fit for the kingdom of God. So our worship of God actually helps us in the spiritual call that we've received to work out our salvation in Jesus Christ and to seek heaven. So, you know, the idea that, you know, we go to God, we go to worship because somehow we're doing God a favor.
Yeah.
Or, you know, these bizarre thinkings that we find in people and in conversations. But no, God doesn't need this. In fact, it's interesting, just as a compare contrast, you know, if we think that God is this removed figure, some distance from us, that we are to fear, and that he needs our worship, and, you know, he's one person, and we have to then give him this praise, and if we don't, then somehow we've offended him or have diminished him, and so on. You know, and that might be the view of many Christians, but they just have to understand that summary of worship is actually more in line with Islamic theology.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so sometimes I tell Christians when they describe stuff like that, I'm like, you know, you are a very devout Muslim. You know what I mean? But
that's not what we believe, yeah.
Exactly, you know. So, yeah, just to realize that he wants our worship. He welcomes our worship.
Yeah.
He will accept our worship, however imperfect it might be.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, it kind of reminds me, when you really think about it, and I, you know, we talk about being the image of God, we mirror, you know, who he is for us in a sense, in our goodness. And when you think about that in, like for myself, a married relationship, right? I didn't need my husband. I could live without him. I mean, you know, and I have since he's passed away, but I wanted, you know, I wanted to be with my husband. And so I liken that, and maybe I'm off base here and you can tell me, but I liken that, to, you know, God with us. He doesn't need us, but he wants us there. And because I wanted to be with my husband, that was the ability for love to be returned and love to grow. And and to understand self-sacrificial love more and more. And that's so I, for me, when I looked at it through that lens, it was like, oh yeah, okay. Because sometimes when you just hear, well, God doesn't need you, you go, what do you mean?
right.
I'm offended.
In English, it sounds very dismissive,
yeah.
Or as if somehow we're insignificant, or,
yeah.
You know, but then you put it in the context of, no, he wants you.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and again, I find that even more endearing, the fact
yeah.
that, you know, he's infinitely perfect. He doesn't need me,
oh.
but he chooses to want me
yeah.
and calls me to himself.
Yeah, I love that. Well, I want to get into the idea of the virtue of religion a little bit more. Okay. So, but I've got so many notes here, Father. When we talk about revelation, right? You say, and you give this cultural argument, which I love. You say the full cult, because it's, you were talking about the coexist bumper sticker, like everything is the same kind of thing. And
mm-hmm.
and you say the full cultural argument goes something like this. Religion isn't necessary. God is whatever you want him to be. You can believe whatever you want. Your religion is for you. No one has any higher claim on a knowledge of God. Don't be a jerk and tell me what to believe. Coexist and be happy. And I think, man, you know, this is really kind of where we are. Kind of everything is the same. Nothing is different. Don't, you know, just let things go. How does that kind of fly in the face of our understanding then of this God is real?
Yes. When we make ourselves the center of everything, then it shouldn't surprise us that we just mess everything up. So when we start thinking that we can determine everything, even, you know, the reality and identity of God, you know, we can distort his revelations, we can change his moral teachings. You know, we see it in our society. We see the consequences of that. So people who are demanding now because, well, you know, if someone is, you know, of older age, or if they have, you know, some serious illness or children with special needs, well, we should just, you know, we should take their life. That's mercy, right?
Right.
And we see in terms of no-fault divorce. Well, the person doesn't make me happy anymore, so, you know, instead of we're calling it quits, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or in the transgender movement,
mm-hmm.
even more aggressively.
Yep.
You know, they're given gender, like, at birth, like who they are, observably, mm-hmm. they're going to rebel against that. And so, you know, all this happens when reality is not respected, and the respecting of reality begins with the proper understanding of God. So we get worship right, we get life right. And so, you know, this whole summary you just read is very relativistic.
Yep.
So I become the standard of my own life.
Mm-hmm.
It's all about my preferences, my emotions, what I want. Well, that's a very small world that is very narcissistic, that is very self-focused, and ultimately the recipe for misery.
Yeah.
So people say, I don't know what the meaning of my life is. I don't know, you know, what I'm supposed to do. I don't know if my life is worth living.
Mm-hmm.
This is where we are when we abandon things outside of ourselves. Because we make our world so small, it becomes very dark and very miserable. Get
yeah.
lonely.
Yeah.
Isolated. And this is regrettably where, you know, the Western world has taken human existence. And so I think the very refreshing aspect is, we can open up the windows.
Yep.
We can expand our world. We can allow divinity, God himself, to enter into our world, and all the transcendent and the prayer and the virtue and the goodness and the love and the relationships that come with that.
Yeah.
So we can choose which path. But if we're going to follow the way of the Lord, we have to understand, yes, there will be times we have to say no to ourselves.
Yeah.
That what I want or what I feel or what I prefer is no longer the standard of my life.
Yeah.
So it becomes, what is God calling me to be? I want to be his children. I want to cooperate with his grace. I want to do what he's asking of me. I want to be in healthy and loving relationships with those around me. And so it's, like, you know, it's so interesting that we hear these cultural mantras of you know, this like self-autonomy and radical autonomy, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I scratch my head because I'm like, who's living that? Like, I'm told when I could put my garbage can out on the street.
Yeah.
You know, like, if I do it on the wrong day, I'm getting fined. Like, you know, who's in any relationship where you just do whatever you want?
I know.
It's like, that's just not reality, right? At least not healthy reality.
Yeah, yeah. I know. I always tell my students that, you know, it amazes me how willingly you accept rules and laws from a government and think that's okay. And yet, and it's imposed on you. Like you said, you'll get fined or you could even go to jail or whatever else if you don't follow the rule. But when it comes to the law of God, why is he so oppressive? It's like, and he's not going to fine you. Yeah.
Or the implicit rules that exist in relationships.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, for example, between spouses or parents and children, especially adult children, among friends. So if I tell my friend, hey, let's get together to watch this new movie, and we agree to meet, and I'm standing in front of the movie theater, there's an implicit rule that that person's going to show up.
Exactly.
Right?
Right.
And if they don't, and they haven't called or texted and said, oh, yeah, I changed my mind, decided I don't really want to watch that movie.
Yeah.
Well, you were going to tell me?
Yeah. It's kind of rude.
You're not the boss of me, right? Who do you think you are telling me what to do, right?
Yeah. I know.
It's like, okay, that person's not going to have any friends after a while, you know?
Yeah. So, okay, Father, I want to jump into this whole thing of virtue. Obviously, we're the virtuous life here. So you talk about the virtue of religion, and you talk about virtue as a whole. And so and one of your subtitles here is Virtue and Its Reward. So can you kind of, first of all, give it, and I love your definition of virtue in here. So can you kind of give us the snapshot of what is virtue and what is the reward of virtue?
Yes, yes. So simply put, we can understand virtue is a good habit. So something that conforms to moral goodness that we have allowed to become second nature to ourselves. So that's a practical definition.
Mm-hmm.
A broader understanding of virtue is it's allowing a moment of grace and a moment of holiness in a specific act at a specific time.
Okay.
So someone is being belligerent to me and rude and disrespectful, and I can reciprocate that, or I can die to myself and give kindness. And if I choose kindness, I exercise the virtue of kindness, then in a dark moment, I have allowed light to come forth.
Mm-hmm.
Because of that act of virtue. More broadly, we can say that virtue has, in one sense, no reward other than itself. But in a broader, eternal sense, virtue has the reward of cooperating with grace.
Okay.
Which means we get closer to God.
Right.
We are able to love more selflessly. So there are always, it's like looking at a diamond, there are always so many different dimensions and perspectives. At the end of the day, we know we're called to virtue. Because we're called to be holy, because we're called to be like our Father in heaven. We're His children, we're supposed to look like Him. Right?
Yeah, right.
And we look like Him by cooperating with grace. With His, grace is His life, His power within us. So there are so many aspects of virtue that we're called to, and the more we accept that virtuous life, the more we allow ourselves to cooperate with grace, to grow in holiness, the more we look like our Father in heaven.
Oh, I like that. So something that comes up, and we kind of touched on it a little bit as we were talking, but I'd like a little bit more from you on this, because I think this is something I think we certainly see in our culture around us, and it's hard, I think, for people to understand. But you talk about virtue is the guardian of our freedom, and then you also go on to say, and so as the moral law secures freedom, so the law and freedom become the means for grace to ennoble a person to exercise virtue. But this whole idea of freedom is it seems to fly in the face of virtue, especially how we define freedom. So can you give us a little more insight into that?
Oh, yes, yes. And you know, it shouldn't surprise us that our fallen world has redefined all of our words. Especially the words that most touch the human heart.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so earlier I was talking about how, you know, mercy now is being used to describe basically euthanasia.
Right.
And it's like, how is that mercy?
Right.
Oh, the word's been redefined, right?
Mm-hmm.
And love has been redefined.
Mm-hmm.
And it shouldn't surprise us that freedom has been redefined. this freedom, and this is in our tradition, in every healthy, thriving civilization in the course of human history, freedom in those contexts have always been understood as the power to do what is right, the power to do what is good and noble.
Right.
So it's not being hindered or suppressed either internally or externally to doing what is right and good. And that's freedom.
Mm.
Redefinition is, freedom means you can do whatever you want.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
And St. Paul in this letter to the Galatians says, actually, no, that's licentiousness. Licentiousness is basically immorality.
Mm-hmm.
And in a broader context, we can say to believe that you can do whatever you want is actually barbarism.
Yeah.
There are no rules or hindrances or virtue or expectations or duties that you are bound to think that you are completely liberated from everything. I mean, that's the lie of the devil.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
And it's the path to barbarism. And we see that in our society, regrettably. The more the West abandons the Christian foundation, the more we see the return of barbaric practices. And so I think by understanding freedom, say, freedom is the power to do what is right and good. And then it's like, then what's right and good? Mm-hmm. I need the moral law. The moral law teaches me and disciplines me. And the more I allow myself to be taught by the moral law, then suddenly I create the arena in which virtue and holiness can be brought forth because I'm beginning to cooperate with grace. But let me say this practically. Like, a child is taught the difference between a lie and the truth.
Right.
A child is then taught you should always tell the truth, not the lie.
Mm-hmm.
And early on, we discipline the child when they tell a lie. And we reward and reinforce when they tell the truth. And eventually the child begins to realize, I should just tell the truth because it's the right thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually the reward isn't needed anymore.
Exactly.
And the punishment isn't feared anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually the child just begins to tell the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And what we see there is a summary of what we're talking about is, first there's the awareness of right and wrong. There's the discipline of right and wrong. And then there's the birth of virtue, where suddenly, so St. Paul, when he says the moral law eventually fades away, he's talking about that the Christian, the believer by grace, has now come to virtue. I mean,
right.
We couldn't imagine Mother Teresa sitting around, and making fun of people.
Yeah.
Or telling inappropriate jokes or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
We couldn't imagine, right?
Right.
Because there's an example of someone who had been so transformed by grace, had so much virtue and achieved levels of holiness that the moral law, once it's faded away, it had fulfilled its role. It guarded freedom. It molded and shaped freedom so they could cooperate with grace and receive virtue and holiness.
So Father, when you say later in this, you make the statement, since our nature is fallen, virtues can be difficult to form. Our sinfulness takes away from who we are and actually makes us less ourselves.
Oh, yes.
And I think it's so often, like, if we define freedom as I can do anything I want, we think that makes us more ourselves. I have more control, more whatever. But according to this statement, when we don't have a proper understanding of freedom, we actually make ourselves less, or we become less ourselves. Can you kind of explain that for us? How does that all connect?
So first let me just start with the cold and hard truth that sin is a liar, a deceiver. Sin is a thief. It steals what does not belong to it. So every promise that sin gives to us is a lie. And every promise that sin tells us, it wants to do the opposite. And so when sin tells us, if you do this, if you follow what I'm telling you, if you accept, my rule, this life of sin, then you can be more yourself. Then you'll be free. And all that's a lie, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's the opposite of that. Follow the path of sin, you become a slave. Follow the path of sin, you become less free.
Mm-hmm.
You are literally chained to your own passions, your own preferences. Like, you become almost incapable of love. So that's just the reality of the lies of sin.
Mm-hmm.
And our theological tradition has always said that we use this term that sin is a privation.
Right.
And what we mean by that is that, as you were describing, Pat, like, that when we do something, when we commit a sin, we become less ourselves. So now just compare and contrast that. Earlier we were talking, we said when we worship, we become more of ourselves in Christ, right?
Yeah.
So grace, worship builds us up. Sin takes away. And so, yeah, someone can actually be in a state of sin for such a duration of time that they honestly feel like they are a stranger to themselves.
Mm.
Meaning, purpose, value, it all gets lost and muddied.
Yeah.
And so the consequences of sin are grave. I mean, ultimately, St. Paul tells us that the wage of sin is death.
Right.
We know physical death, but for many people, that can even be a spiritual death.
Right. But, Father, would this be kind of an example of, obviously, I've worked with a lot of young people over my lifetime, but, you know, when I was in high school work, if kids were discipline issues, they had to come see me. So the idea that, you know, when you get a kid to say, I don't know why I did that. You know, I don't know why I did that. That's just not me. Is that kind of what we're talking about? They have lost kind of the connection to who they are made to be. And so now they become less of themselves when they do something like this.
Yes. Yes. In fact, I think we've all been in situations to greater or lesser extent where our sinfulness has shocked us.
Yes.
Like, how did I say that or go along with that or was involved in that or do that? Like, so absolutely. We see it in children who can be oftentimes be a little more expressive.
Mm-hmm.
But in our own ways, even as adults that have gone through our life, we've been shocked, you know, like, it's like how that happened. And in large part, it's because we started believing whispered lies.
Because,
you know, bias is, you know, deception. And, you know, it makes small inroads through small compromises.
Right.
And then eventually we lose ourselves. And this sin is committed, or we or an accomplice to it, or something, and it's just like, what is going on?
Yeah.
So very much so. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Well, one of the things too that that you talk about, and I see this a lot in, I always caution people to be careful with this. So you talk about humanity, therefore, is defined by goodness and love, but a lot of people think when we talk about original sin, that means we're bad. So can you kind of, I kind of get it, I've got it in my head, but I want you to kind of explain, okay, what does it mean we are good and holy, and how does original sin fit into that then?
Yeah, so to draw from the spiritual masters, to give this really graphic example where you can imagine this beautiful, beautiful temple, very ornate, majestic, splendorous, just beautiful and awe-inspiring, you know. And someone walks into that temple and lets off a grenade. And the grenade, you know, detonates, and the blast is so severe that everything inside the temple is now thrown into complete disarray, and there's chaos. The walls were able to sustain the blast, so the temple still stands. But everything inside is not where it's supposed to be. Well, in many respects, that's what original sin did to our human nature and to creation. And to your point, Pat, the walls still stood. So human nature is still good, not because of anything that it has done, but because human nature is a gift from God. Sin cannot steal the goodness that God has given to creation and to our human nature.
Okay.
And so the walls have stood. But everything is mixed up inside.
Right.
Right. So, you know, we call good evil, evil good. We don't sometimes naturally know goodness. We have to receive some type of formation or to understand it more fully. And everything is off, right? And we call that concupiscence in our theological tradition. It means we're just inclined to sin now. Right? We can know something is sin and want it. And we can know something is good for ourselves or others and not do it. And that's just a disorder.
Right.
That just shows the chaos. But human nature is good. That's our only hope. Like when we talk about redemption, what's being redeemed? Our human nature.
Mm-hmm.
It's still good. It's being redeemed, right? Mm. So it's being brought to its fullness.
Right.
So goodness, and again, that's our hope. That's what God is building on. That's what he's restoring, what he's redeeming. So So I think people say, no, humanity, we're just evil, and so on. It's like, no, that would be too easy.
Right.
They just, we're just evil, and there's no hope for us. No, no, actually, we are good, but we can do evil.
Right.
Now the real work has to start. And we have to change.
And that is the work of Lent, isn't it?
Amen. Yes, amen.
Well, Father, I'm going to, 1 minute I'm going to give you here, because I'm looking at our time. You talk about when we touch on the virtue of religion, but we'll touch more on it next week. But you say religion, the word religion comes from the Latin word meaning to bind oneself. So therefore, the virtue of religion is binding. Can you give us a little bit of insight of what that means for us?
Yes, it means that we are in a covenant with God. We belong to a community. We are part of a tradition. We are part of a way of life, that our life, our existence, is greater than ourselves, that we are part of something greater than ourselves. And you compare that and contrast it with the, you know, the isolation and the narcissism of our contemporary world, we can see why religion becomes so countercultural, because it is binding. It is accepting something beyond ourselves.
Yeah. And I think as we kind of close out the show here, one of the things that you talk about, because obviously a Lenten series here, right? Religion includes death to self. And we talk about mortification through Lent all the time. But I want to kind of close with some of your words here, Father. The virtue of religion begins with the free choice by each of us to reciprocate God's love, to give him his due, and to properly worship him above all things. This is the virtue of religion. This is what each person is called to accept and to integrate into his own life. Have we? I love that. That question, I think, really sets us up as we engage Lent. So I really want to thank you, Father. Thanks so much. Father Jeff Kirby was with us today to start us out on our Lenten journey, and we're talking about his book, Real Religion. Thanks again, Father. We'll talk to you next week.
Take care.
All right. And again, Father Jeff Kirby, he's a host of a daily devotional, The Morning Offering with Father Kirby. So look that up and stay with us as we continue to dig into this wonderful book, Real Religion. It will really be a great Lenten journey for you. Thanks so much for listening to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray. Let the voice of truth.